Bernards Township encompasses about 25 miles square. And within that area, we have four villages. Basking Ridge is one of those villages. We also have Liberty Corner, Lyons Corner, and West Millington. So those are all villages that are in Bernards Township.
In 1806, Warren Township had been part of Bernards. 1806, Warren became an independent township, and in 1921, Far Hills broke away from us, and in 1924, Bernardsville broke away from us. So originally, Bernards Township was a much larger area than it is now. It was basically a farming area. It was it wasn't until the advent, really, of the coming of the railroad that it got to be a little bit more sophisticated. But there were people that, you know, didn't travel into the city. We had the stagecoach that came with the mail. And years ago, as I tell children, when you got a letter, you paid for the postage, not the person who sent it to you. Then, of course, when they wanted to connect the railroad in this area, then this was a great impetus for the wealthy to come out from the city and build these palatial homes. And that was really the start of the Bernardsville Mountain Colony. We have some wonderful estates in the Bernardsville Mountain, the Posts and the Saneys and the Drydens, people that came out and wanted to live because they know they had a wonderful access to the railroad station, yet they could be away from the city. This Bernards Township, of course, is also the home of the United States Golf Association. It's a wonderful home that had been built by John Pope, and it was home, the carriage house of the USGA is the residence of Cyrus Vance, who was the Secretary of State. We have the USGA. This is also the home of the United States Veterans Administration Medical Center. This is the headquarters of AT&T. I'm sure you're aware of that. The Crum and Foster, Ingersoll Rand, Bonnie Bray, the Bonnie Bray School. We have the Lord Sterling School. It's a very prestigious mailing address. We have under 20,000 people. It offers many services. But getting back to the way it was, the Basking Ridge Village in itself was so different than the village of Liberty Corner. Liberty Corner was really more of a dairying area, and with the advent of the railroad, they were able to ship their cream down to Newark and into hotels in the city. And the people, I laughed, I said to a woman 99 years old, why would you have to have a Presbyterian church in Liberty Corner when there's a Presbyterian church in Basking Ridge? And she looked at me and said, Mrs. Kennedy, because the one in Basking Ridge is too far away. We can joke about it now because we have cars, but 5 miles is a long way, particularly if you had a snowstorm, and that's why the Liberty Corner Presbyterian Church was founded in the 1830s. There are some charming stories about some of the churches. I'll tell you one. When the Methodist Church was going to be built, the present one, the minister, the Reverend Joseph Apley, was given permission to walk the property on South Maple Avenue by John Jacob Astor IV. And Mr. Apley, who was indigent, had his cane and walked the property and put crosses on the stones. And on the weekends, members of his congregation would take their horse and wagons, and they would pick up the stones. And those are the ones that face the building of the Basking Ridge Methodist Church. Ironically, this John Jacob Astor IV, 18 years later, was the man who died in the sinking of the Titanic in 1912 when his wife was expecting their first child. And then, ironically, it was that child, born several months later, who in 1968 sold this building to the township. This was John Jacob Astor VI, who now resides in Florida. And my burning desire is to find out, why did John Jacob Astor VI choose this town to buy this mansion? Was it because he had an intuitive feeling that this was the area? His father had bought land, the father he never knew. And I'm still going through the records trying to find out what the Astor connection was. But I really plan to do a booklet on the history of this building, which is a very exciting building. This building was built in 1913 by Samuel Owen, who was a Newark pharmaceutical magnate, and he only stayed here in the summertime. He called this Cedar Hill Farm. He and his wife had no children, and as I had mentioned, the O over over the fireplace was his coat of arms. He purchased the most choice piece of property on the ridge, 100 acres, in 1913, and he grew peaches there as an avocation. And then when he died, his trustee sold the estate to Mr. George Lee, Mr. George Lee of the Red Devil Tool Company. Now, Mr. and Mrs. Lee lived in this house for 6 years, but they were very generous people, and they no sooner purchased the property that they gave away 60 acres to the Board of Education for the erection of Cedar Hill School and for Ridge High School, and another 12 acres for the War Memorial Field. So the present building we are in sits on 28 acres. And when the Lees moved to a bigger home in Bernardsville in 46, it was bought by the Bissells. They were here briefly, and then it was purchased by John Jacob Astor VI, this baby who was born after his father died. And he also, Mr. Astor, also conducted a farm which was across the way on South Maple Avenue. It was called, the original farm had been called Bakehaven Farm, but then he took it over and he made it a dairy farm. And he also had property in Florida, and he would ship orange blossoms and orange leaves up so that he had fragrancy in his stables for his barns. That area now, of course, is the Lord Sterling Park of the Park Commission, Somerset County Park Commission. And what's interesting is the fact that the horses are in stalls that are much too large, because they really are in cow stalls. And Mr. Astor never really made a go of the farm, but it was a fun thing for him. He was into several things. This building was vacant for 8 years, and as I had mentioned, it was supposed to be demolished, but the cost would have been prohibitive, and so the township purchased this and decided in 68 to move the police station into the building. The whole entire complex, the municipal complex, had been housed at the Brick Academy. Backing off, the Brick Academy originally, as I said, in 1852 had been part of the public school system, and then in 1903, when Maple Avenue School was built, which is now the site of our library, the academy was sold to the American United Workers, similar to a labor group. They sold it to the Junior Order United American Mechanics in 28, and in 46 it was sold to the township. And in this little building, they ran this town. They had the police downstairs in the lower level, and they had the tax collector and the town clerk and the Board of Health and the various agencies in one building until they did move here. By then they had put an addition onto this building for the police, who anyway this July moved into their new headquarters. So this building is now the municipal complex.
We have several departments that are located in this particular building. We have the administration, the court facilities, then we also have engineering and the construction department. So those are all located in this particular building. The carriage house over on Finley Avenue is our health department. And then if you go around the other block on Maple, a few years ago we put in a new public works building. And a couple of years ago we renovated the upper portion of that, and we have our finance located over there and recreation. The recreation department will soon be moving to some newly renovated areas in this particular building, and those are the spaces that the police were located in. And the police have a new building that is just down the road from the Astor estate here. And so those are pretty much the buildings that we have. We're sort of located in one corner of the town. We have everything right here on one campus. So we've enjoyed it. It's a nice campus area, and we try to keep the flavor of the estate and the architecture. Hopefully we've done that with the new police building.
Right, in 1946, a full-time department was organized in Bernards Township. The chief at that time was Chief W. Robert Moore, whom was my father, And he was chief until 1951. At that particular time, in 1951, Harry Allen was appointed police chief. And Harry Allen was police chief until 1977, at which time he retired after completing 30 years. I remember Bernards Township as far as the police department, a one-man car patrol. We have the different divisions. We have the detective division. We have our crime prevention officer in Bernards Township, operations officer, and all those sort of things. But in those days, you were it. If for some reason, and then this happened quite frequently, the chief was off, you was the chief. You were the one that were making all the decisions as a police officer. You were the crime prevention officer when you went to different homes and, well, what can we do to safeguard our homes? You were the juvenile officer. This is really a change from today's specialization of everything.
I think it's great for children to know that there were real, live, historic, and heroic people that lived in our area. I know it's great to see these figments of people's imaginations in video cassettes and on television, but you know, you had many interesting people in our area. Take, for instance, our Brick Academy, the Basking Ridge Classical School, our headquarters, founded in 1809. One of the students there was Robert Field Stockton, who was Commodore of the and hero of the Mexican War. Another one was Alexander Lynn, who cast the deciding vote in the tie vote of Jefferson against Aaron Burr to be president of the United States. Another person would have been William Dayton, who ran on the Republican Party, the first Republican candidate. Before that, it had been the Whig Party, with John C. Fremont in 1856. Mr. Dayton lost the election, but he was President Lincoln's appointment to ambassador to France during the Civil War. We had Samuel Southard, who was educated at the Brick Academy, who was a governor of New Jersey, and he was a United States senator. His father was a member of the House of Representatives, and together they worked on the Missouri Compromise. Just trying to think of other people. We had Kirkpatrick, who was a Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. We had the Frelinghuysens, who were also in the United States Senate. So these are people that lived in our area, and of course one of the most dashing people would be William Alexander, Lord Stirling, third in command of American forces, who built this tremendous home called Stirling Manor, which he never finished, and that was built in town, and it was a place that hosted Lafayette and Washington and Knox, and when his daughter Kitty was married, there was a tremendous reception there. We've had the triumphant French army march from Suffren down to Whippany through Liberty Corner on their way to Richmond. This whole area just screams for history. We have 35 veterans buried underneath the oak tree at the Presbyterian Church. When General Lee was to be arrested, the British hid out the night before in the farmhouse, which is presently the convent at St. James, and they went across the street to the Widow White's Tavern the next day. And ironically, 2 years later, when Lee was charged with insubordination at the Battle of Monmouth in 1778, on my birthday, June 28th, it was William Alexander who sat at his court-martial. So this is living history. These are people that went up and down these streets and who lived in some of these homes. And I think it's nice for children to know that they're in this kind of an environment. The people who came here, really, the aristocracy, tried to duplicate what they had in England. And I give so much credit to the people who came here because they wanted a freedom of worship to better themselves. But you take, for instance, the people who, when they first came here, there was no school system. There was no public school system. It wasn't until 1852 that they could have classes at the Brick Academy because it had been a boys' private school, and it did educate children to go to the College of New Jersey, which is called Princeton, but there wasn't anything for girls. And finally, the law was passed, and so we had a public school system with four grades up and four grades down. But before that, just imagine how people, what they could make of themselves just through improving themselves through learning or reading the Bible. And I show children a book, a textbook from the Brick Academy that was printed in 1818, and I let every child feel the texture of the page, and I say, this doesn't feel like paper, does it? And they say, no, and I said, well, it isn't. It's made with rags. Do you realize how lucky you are that you've got books and you have a pencil and you don't have to write with a slate and a piece of chalk? And it gives them a deep appreciation to sit in a building which had been so basic, with four big grades downstairs and four little ones upstairs, to sit, and now they have a school where they have audio visual, they have library services, and I want them really to realize they don't have to go to school. They should want to go to school because they have so much more offered to them, and the people who had so little made so much more of themselves. I really do it. Want them to feel that this is an impetus for them to take advantage of everything that's offered to them. We have a marvelous school system in Bernards Township.
Ridge High School is the high school for Bernards Township students. Bernards is for Bernardsville. So our students go to Ridge High School, and our junior high school is Annan. And we have a Cedar Hill school, which is now encompasses fourth and fifth grades. And then we have two elementary schools, Liberty Corner Elementary School and Oak Street Elementary School. Bernards Township has a township committee form of government. You're elected to the township committee for a three-year term, and those are staggered. It's 2-2-1 running. From among those five that are elected to the township committee, one person is appointed mayor, and that person usually holds the position for a year, and then it passes on to the deputy mayor, because most of the time our township committee people have other jobs. So it's not a full-time position. We have a township administrator who runs the government or the keeps things going. We are really the policy-making group, and so that's really our form of government. It's a weak mayor. They call it a weak mayor form of government. The mayor has one vote, the same as all of the other township committee members. I feel very special towards Bernards Township, and I think a lot of people do when they move here. They are interested in it for lots of different reasons. The historical aspect could be one. The fact that it's much like the countryside, so they enjoy living in that kind of atmosphere. So there are a number of reasons why people move here, and I don't think that we're better than maybe lots of other places, but when you move here, you sort of get the feeling for it and work toward some goals that you have in mind, or just enjoy being in this part of New Jersey.
I'd come on the police department in 1948, and I think it was on a one-to-one basis. We knew everyone. We knew everyone. If we had a problem, such as with a teenager or whoever, you went to the home, and that's where you'd done your office work. As it is today, they come into us here at the police department, and I think this maybe changes things a little bit.
We have a lot going for us here. We have two nice historic districts. We have a beautiful township hall. We have a progressive government, and we really, if we all get together, I think we can only go up. We can only go. I'm very enthusiastic.
I think we're pretty much holding our own, and of course this is going to depend on the economy now. Everything seems to be on a hold. I think we're in relatively good shape to stay where we are, as long as I plan on retiring in July of 91. And I have two other sergeants that will be retiring in April. As long as they're replaced, I don't know that we've got to add on, but as long as we keep replacing these people, we should be in good shape. This headquarters was built to house 40 officers. So I think as far as the headquarters goes, we're okay. We're in good shape.
Well, we've had a slowdown with development. We've been able to see that with our planning board meetings. We've had fewer planning board meetings since we've seen, I guess we can call it a recession or whatever, but it has slowed down quite a bit. So I'm not sure what the future is going to bring, whether we'll be back to that growth period again in a couple of years. I don't know. We did have that for a few years, and we've had some problems because of that, the traffic problems and finding enough parking for people and all of the things that are involved with an influx of people. But I think we've managed it fairly well, and I'm not sure what the future is going to bring. Be nice if we could look into a crystal ball, I guess, but maybe not so nice. It's kind of nice to be able to solve these problems as they come along.